Penguin Random House Audio presents Eleanor and Hick, The Love Affair That Shaped a First Lady, by Susan Quinn. Read for you by Kimberly Farr. Introduction. By the time Franklin Roosevelt was elected president in 1932, his wife, Eleanor, had succeeded in forging an independent life for herself, a life of teaching, writing, and political activism. Now she was about to become First Lady, with all the duties that would entail. In the midst of the victory celebrations, Eleanor was filled with dread about her future. Lorena Hickok, a top reporter assigned to cover the new First Lady for the Associated Press, was one of the few who noticed Eleanor's unhappiness and took it seriously. Hickok, Hick, to everyone who knew her, worked patiently to gain Eleanor's trust. By the time she wrote her stories for the AP, Eleanor and Hick had fallen in love. Hick knew both the publishable and the unpublishable reasons for Eleanor's unhappiness. She wrote a profile that was frank about Eleanor's reluctance to become First Lady, but without revealing all the reasons why. America was in the depths of the Great Depression. Banks were running out of money, unemployment was spiraling upward, and there was a very real possibility that the country would erupt in violence. Americans were in desperate need of the leadership Franklin Roosevelt was promising to provide. Eleanor would become FDR's most important partner in the great challenges he faced. She would often act as his conscience, reminding him of the human cost of his political decisions, and urging him to speak out courageously about racism and inequity. But more and more, as FDR waited to assume the presidency, Eleanor found excuses to spend her days and nights with Hick. It would be hard to imagine a less likely pair than Eleanor and Hick. Eleanor had grown up in a mansion on the Hudson, with nannies and maids, while Hick had worked as a maid in other people's houses, starting at age 14, in the bleak railroad towns of South Dakota. Yet, despite vastly different circumstances, both women had lonely and loveless childhoods, and both needed the kind of deep caring they gave to each other. Hick would have loved to settle down with Eleanor for life. It will never be clear if Eleanor could or would have agreed to such an arrangement. Still, she loved Hick in a new and thrilling way. In other times and circumstances, she and Hick might have been able to make a life together, like the other women partners in their circle. But Hick and Eleanor's intimacy would have to fit in around not only Eleanor's marriage, but also momentous national and world events. After FDR was elected, Hick quietly moved into the White House, where she stayed off and on for the entire 13 years of the Roosevelt presidency. During those years, Eleanor and Hick managed to form a partnership that transformed their lives and contributed in a major way to important initiatives of the New Deal. When they weren't together, Eleanor and Hick wrote tenderly of their longing for one another. "Oh, how I wanted to put my arms around you in reality instead of in spirit," Eleanor wrote Hick during the first year of their relationship. "I went and kissed your photograph instead, and tears were in my eyes." "There have been times," Hick wrote from San Francisco after they vacationed together out west in the summer of 1934. "When I've missed you so much that it has been like a physical pain. And at those times, I've hated San Francisco because you were not there." Eleanor loved Hick for many reasons, but it didn't hurt that such a relationship was considered a subversive act within her well-born family. Hick was a woman, for one thing. She was also a reporter, a species that FDR's Aunt Cassie proudly asserted she had never spoken to in her life. Aunt Cassie, like others in her circle, believed a lady's name should only appear in print at the time of her coming out, her marriage, and her death. Hick had a peaches and cream complexion and beautiful, shapely legs, but weighed 200 pounds and dressed without frills in a tailored style. She reveled in food and drink, played a good game of poker, smoked a lot, including an occasional cigar, and was capable of swearing a blue streak. Unlike Eleanor, who kept strong emotions under control, Hick let it all out. When she was typing out a sob story, tears would run down her cheeks. When she wrote a humorous piece, her laughter shook her entire body. Hick was fun to be with, but she was also tempestuous. Her letters to Eleanor were often written in a fury about one injustice or another, especially after she went on the road for New Deal relief boss Harry Hopkins to report on the desperate poverty of the Depression years. "This valley is the damnedest place I ever saw," she wrote Eleanor from El Centro, California. If you don't agree with them, you are a communist, of course. And another time, when the Red Cross was withholding warm clothes for an emergency, "Good God, I wonder what constitutes an emergency in the eyes of the old ladies who run the Red Cross." Eleanor's upbringing would never allow her to express herself so emphatically. But Hick's embrace gave her the courage to open up, more than she ever had before, about her true feelings. "I'm back at my worst verge of tears condition, which I hoped I could eliminate this summer," she wrote Hick in August 1935. "I only hope no one else realizes it, and I don't think they do, for I look well." Eleanor and Hick's epistolary relationship was a rare and remarkable thing. They poured out their longing in thousands of letters. But they also used the letters to tell the stories of their time. Hick's journalistic training served her well as she reported on the terrible human cost of the Depression. She was good at gathering facts, good at getting people to talk, and good at vivid storytelling. Officially, she was reporting to Harry Hopkins, but she told Eleanor all the same stories, and some extra ones, in her long and detailed letters. The letters and reports added urgency to Eleanor's advocacy for people in need, and sometimes even made it to the president's desk. At other times, Hick described situations so harrowing that they sent Eleanor into action. One of Hick's reports about coal mining families in West Virginia impelled Eleanor to hop in her roadster and drive down and see for herself. Not long after, she and others drew up plans for Arthurdale, a homestead community to house the mining families. Arthurdale was the first of the many resettlement projects for destitute families built by the Roosevelt administration. It started with a report from Hick. Eleanor's letters to Hick are a kind of reportage themselves, chronicling her life in the fishbowl of the White House, more honest by far than her published accounts. They came so frequently that Hick, out in the field reporting on the lives of poor people, asked Eleanor to use special plain stationery. The embossed gold letterhead of the White House was an embarrassment when it arrived at a post office in Bemidji, Minnesota, or Jessup, Georgia. Eventually, Eleanor's long and detailed descriptions of her days in the White House led Hick to suggest she take her story to the world. My Day, the daily column that brought Eleanor Roosevelt into the homes of America, grew directly out of the private diary reports that she first sent to Hick. Eleanor became a word-producing marvel. She wrote her column 6 times a week from the 1930s until almost the end of her life. She also wrote memoirs that purported to be the story of her life. These, it must be said, are more fiction than fact when it comes to Eleanor's feelings about her marriage, her mother-in-law, her troubled children, and her life in general. The My Day column and the memoirs are useful as a record of events, but they paint an unreal picture of the emotional life of Eleanor Roosevelt. The letters between Eleanor and Hick tell a truer and more compelling story, not just of Eleanor, but also of the lesser-known but brilliant journalist and chronicler of the Great Depression.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.